Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. We suggest that viewers who are sensitive to the life sciences have an adult view this video first, to ensure it is suitable for that viewer. If you've not already done so, we suggest that you first watch the videos on ecosystems and plants before watching this video. These Egyptian pyramids were built about 4,500 years ago. That's a long time ago. But even before these pyramids were built, a tree that looks just like this one began its life and is still alive in California. The exact location and picture of that tree is a secret held by the U.S. government in an effort to prevent tourists from accidentally harming or killing it. As of 2023, that tree's scientifically confirmed age is 4,855 years old, making it the oldest known organism in Earth's history. Each unique type of organism is called a species. Although this tree species makes it look easy, surviving in nature it is incredibly hard. For a species to avoid going extinct, which is the scientific word that means all of its members have died, that species must have some members survive at least long enough to start a new generation of members. More specifically, for a member of a species to survive, it must overcome three major challenges. 1. Get enough energy and nutrients to stay alive. 2. Avoid being killed, such as by being eaten. 3. Avoid dying due to a harsh environment. Then the fourth challenge for the species to exist. It's for some of its members to start the next generation. Every solution to one of these challenges is called an adaptive trait. An adaptive trait is a design that an organism starts its life with. That design is carried in its genes that it got from the prior generation. In this video, we will look at a few adaptive traits that plants use to solve these four challenges. We'll start with the first challenge, which is getting enough energy and nutrients to stay alive. In the desert, there is plenty of sunlight, but it rarely rains. In a whole year, there may be only 10 inches of rain that falls. That means that water, which is one of the most important nutrients, is in scarce supply in a desert. When it does rain, plants must be able to soak up as much rainwater as possible, then store it for later. Unlike common pine trees that are tall and narrow, these pine trees are short and have roots that are shallow, but they go out far from its trunk. Having shallow and expansive roots helps this plant soak up what little rain does fall in the desert. And by being short, the water only has to travel a short distance to the leaves. So the leaves have a better chance of surviving even when there's just a little water in the trunk and branches. The desert is famous for having other plants with thick branches like this one. If we cut one of its branches, then we see it is storing so much water that it drips out. This is much different than a common branch that is mostly made of wood. The adaptive trait of storing water in its stems and branches helps some desert plants get through long periods of no rain, which are called droughts. Now, let's leave the desert and go to the rainforest, which has the opposite supply of nutrients and sunlight availability that a desert has. A tropical rainforest can get over 10 feet of rain per year, so getting water is not a challenge. The bigger challenge is getting sunlight. On the forest floor, it is so dark that trees cannot grow. Their only opportunity to grow is when another tree falls down, and for a short time there is sunlight on the forest floor. While there's some sunlight, saplings of different tree species compete to grow to the top of the tree canopy, so they will always have sunlight. The adaptive traits that help a sapling win the competition for sunlight are being able to grow very tall and very quickly. But there is a different way to survive in a forest, as moss shows us. This plant type has an adaptive trait that lets it grow even with just a little sunlight, so it does not have to compete to be the fastest plant to reach the tree canopy over 100 feet high. It stays short and still does well because it only needs a little sunlight. Next, let's review adaptive traits that plants have that help them overcome the second challenge, which is to avoid being killed by being eaten by an animal. Cacti and roses are famous for growing spines and thorns. On thistles, we call them prickles. They all hurt animals. Even common weeds are sharp enough to cut our skin, which is why we wear garden gloves when pulling weeds. Some plants use chemicals to hurt animals that touch them, such as nettles that create painful burns. Other plants, like poison ivy and poison oak, bother people or other animals by creating itchy hives for weeks. Although preventing animals from eating them helps some plants survive, many plants are partially eaten, but survive by regrowing whatever was eaten. It takes grass only a week to grow back after its top is eaten by animals or has been mowed. Likewise, leaves on a tree and entire branches on a tree will grow back after they are eaten or clipped. Growing back something that has been removed is a powerful adaptive trait that many plants use to survive. But that ability is rare among animals. A tree's thick bark helps prevent many animals from damaging the trunk, since if the trunk was damaged, the tree could die, and then termites would eat the tree. Next, let's review adaptive traits that plants have that help them overcome the third challenge, which is to survive if the environment is harsh. Some places have no soft soil, such as in this rocky terrain, but tiny tree seeds may fall into a crack and often grow into trees by splitting rocks as their trunks grow. This process is called biological weathering and is a major part of the rock cycle that we'll cover in a future video. Some places have no soil but only rocks. Plants like moss can grow on rocks or the trunks of trees because they have an adaptive trait that helps them stick to those surfaces. On the other soil extreme, in some places the soil is soft but shallow, so a tree might fall over as it gets bigger. These tall roots are called buttress roots and give the tree a more stable foundation, so it will not tip over. A different adaptive trait to deal with soft and shallow soil is to grow aerial roots. These branches grow roots that eventually reach the soil, and in addition to supporting the heavy branches, widen the tree's foundation so it will not tip over. There are some species of plants, like this gray-colored one, that look like huge spider webs hanging from tree branches. These plants do not even touch the soil, which means they can survive where there is no soil, such as over water, or where the soil is poor quality. This plant is called Spanish moss and is very common in the southeastern states. Although it grows on other trees, it is not a parasite, since it does not take anything from those trees and is easily pulled off. Its name is misleading since it is not from Spain and it is not a moss. Sometimes a place seems to have the perfect soil, sun, water, and no threat from animals. But then the weather changes. Winter is a huge environmental stress on plants, as it is on all living organisms. That's because in the winter there may not be enough warmth, liquid water, or sunlight for sufficient plant growth. Many plants have an adaptive trait called dormancy that they use to get through the winter. We see this as they lose their leaves in the autumn, pause their growth during the winter, and then return to full activity with spring blossoms. During the entire winter, the plants were still alive, but they were inactive. A milder form of dormancy is when the grass turns brown during a drought, then rebounds when it rains. The final challenge that plants and all species have is to help start the next generation. Almost all plants mix their genes with other plants so that they can then make healthy seeds. Some plants mix their genes with other plants through the process of pollination involving animals, by making a sugary fluid called nectar and storing that inside attractive-looking and smelling flowers. The plants attract animals such as insects and hummingbirds to the flowers. Inside those flowers are thin rods covered in yellow pollen that have a copy of the plant's genes inside. As the animals drink the nectar, much of their bodies is covered in yellow pollen. And when those animals go to the next plant, they take that pollen with them, and some of that pollen comes off in the next plant. The end result is that plants that are far away from each other are mixing their genes. Once the plant's genes have been mixed with another plant, the receiving plant can make a seed. The plant must then send that seed to a place where it can grow. Some plants attach the seeds to tiny structures that are like parachutes. And when the wind blows, the seeds go with the wind and may settle in the soil and later grow. A similar technique is to have the seeds attached to large branches that then break off and roll to a new area. This is what happens with tumbleweed. Other plants store their seeds inside fruit. Sometimes we call these pips, but they're all seeds and every one of these can grow into a new plant. Animals come to the plant to get the fruit, then take it away and eat the fruit. In the process, the animals spread the seeds. When those seeds get into the soil, they wait until there is enough moisture and warmth. Then they begin to grow through a process called germination, which makes a new plant generation of that species. All of the adaptive traits we've reviewed are designs. The blueprints for those designs are stored as genes in a molecule called DNA. Each of these box-like structures are living plant cells in a leaf. Inside each cell is a faint colored nucleus, which stores a copy of the plant's DNA. That DNA contains the genes which the plant got from a prior generation. Those genes are like blueprint designs for making adaptive traits. And adaptive traits are the winning designs that prevent a species from going extinct. Here's a review of this topic. Please pause the video if you wish to read this. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.